the decision to go back, to go into alternative asset classes for us as an investment bank happened about 2 years ago, when we realized that there was investor fatigue amongst Kenyans. Because if you look at the asset classes that they were exposed to, the asset classes that they could actually invest in, they had a very limited universe of such assets. Mansa X is a multi-asset strategy fund that is focused on trading in the global financial markets. So we were then licensed as the first ones to be money managers, meaning that we are licensed to actually take funds from the public, make discretionary trading decisions on their behalf, and then offer them a return. So that's what Mansa X does. It trades in five major asset classes. So the first one is currencies. So in currencies, we're talking about the major G10 currencies. So we're talking about trading in the euro, the pound, the Swiss franc, the Canadian dollar, the Japanese yen, all the major world currencies and emerging market currencies. The second category of asset classes is commodities. So we can trade and offer our clients exposure in commodities like oil, natural gas. We can give them exposure even in coffee, even cotton and so on. The third asset class is global stock indices. So we offer our clients exposure to the S&P 500, the Japanese Nikkei, the FTSE 100, the German DAX. Then we also give our clients the ability to buy or sell precious metals. So this is gold, silver, palladium, platinum, and so on. Then the fifth asset class that our clients have exposure to is global single stocks. Due to advancements in technology, and this is what we want to leverage on, we will very soon be launching a product that will give clients exposure to the same markets as we are currently giving the current clients that we have, but give them a much lower minimum investment amount. We are looking to leveraging on mobile accessibility of our fund. We are looking to leveraging on how we use our website to directly allow our clients to open and access their funds without necessarily having to come to our offices in town. Initially, when we got our license and we started trading, we first had to prove this concept. Okay, we had to first show that this is something that can work. This is something that can be done, and it's a really different thing. We are talking about proving that out of Nairobi, you can actually run a fund that invests in markets globally. The response has been overwhelming. Just as we had thought, a lot of Kenyans were looking for a fund that would offer them more diversification, would offer them more liquidity, and would offer them exposure outside the Kenyan boundaries. So we saw that this concept, our initial thoughts were actually, you know, predicated on real issues and requirements by the Kenyan public. And we've then seen a massive interest in the fund up to now. So last year, that is 2019, we delivered a return of 24%. So I believe that's one of the highest in the markets. And there's a reason for this. I've already alluded to the fact that we are a very diversified fund, so meaning we have a lot more opportunities to invest in. The second thing is that we have access to leverage. Okay, we are licensed by the Capital Markets Authority to use leverage in our trading. What this means is when we trade on behalf of our clients, we can invest in markets with a lot more funds than available to us from our clients. Okay, so using some sophisticated methods where we actually grow the funds available for trading based on margin trading, we are able to do that. So this augments our returns. And the other thing that makes us have higher returns is the fact that we can employ the use of a long, short trading strategy. Traditional fund managers have always just been restricted to investing in long-only markets. So we are able to do it a bit differently. And we believe that in the long run, a fund that has the instruments that we have available to them will be able to deliver a much more superior return to our clients. It's always exciting for global markets before the US elections. Now, this time it's even going to be more exciting because we have the current president, Donald Trump, is one of his biggest strengths in his presidency has been a rise in stock market. Yes. Okay, that's the one thing that is most likely going to make him get reelected. And what we then expect to happen this year is we expect to see the Federal Reserve support the U.S. stock market even more. We, in the last 2 months, we've seen the Federal Reserve inject billions of dollars every week into the markets, which has pushed the S&P 500 to the highest levels in history. So we expect that this will continue. And from a geopolitical angle, the concerns we have will continue being around the U.S. and Iran tensions and how that plays out. We are seeing some shifting geopolitical alliances, like recently we used to have an alliance between Turkey and Russia, and now we are seeing as if they are now moving to the U.S. For some major world economies, it's not looking very good. If you look at Japan and Europe, they're literally in recession. Okay, and whether this is going to change anytime soon is not very clear, because a lot of their central banks have really run out of the ammunition that they can use to buoy up markets, because they're already in negative interest rate territory. I believe because, you know, Donald Trump needs to be reelected, and this is his baby, the stock markets. I believe he will do anything it takes to make sure that there's a sustained rally up until after elections. So we still expect that the Nasdaq will continue rising. We still expect that the S&P 500 will continue rising, and the Dow Jones. That is expected. We also suspect that in June, we might actually see the Federal Reserve adjust its, actually cut rates to further buoy up the markets. We expect that that might happen, especially if we see a global slowdown in the economy. We expect that that might happen. Which sectors will continue to be interesting? Right now, the most interesting sector continues to be tech-oriented stocks. If you look at the biggest gainers this year alone, if you look at Tesla, for example, Tesla has exploded. I think 150% growth in 2 months. But that's also because Tesla is also one of the most heavily shorted stocks. So the short sellers were squeezed out and the market erupted. But still, it is a sign of a lot of faith going into tech companies, especially tech companies that that are in line with how the world is moving in terms of how we are moving towards companies that will reduce global emissions. So electric car companies will continue soaring, battery manufacturers will continue soaring, manufacturers of internet chips like Nvidia, we expect that those companies will continue growing in value. I think this year we've seen Microsoft, for example, the stock is up about 18%. That's because cloud-based services will continue being a winner, and companies that provide this will obviously be at the front of the pack. So I'd go for such companies. Those are the companies I'd put my money on, and then I'd probably also go for e-commerce services companies. Because a lot of shopping now is being done online, and those with robust platforms to accommodate this can only continue growing bigger. So like Amazon will be huge and continues to be a good stock to hold. For the euro and the pound as well, they will continue being on the back foot against the dollar. We expect sustained dollar strength, mostly because even from an interest rate parity perspective, you know, the dollar is higher yielding compared to European bonds and British bonds. So I think over time, they will continue to lose value against the dollar. Now, anything to do with Brexit and the political headlines only affect those currencies in the near term. But the long-term trend is that we'll expect a devaluation of the same against the dollar. The only thing I'd say in terms of how do events like Brexit affect the currencies is probably just creating a lot of volatility during the particular periods when they are manifesting themselves. But unless Brexit, then we just expect a continuous, slow and winded loss in value against the dollar. I still think the US stock market will be interesting to watch. It's a good place to put your money just overall, especially from an index perspective, due to the concerns and the risks coming from the coronavirus. And if this persists and there's really no sign that it's slowing down, I would also put my money in gold. Gold is one of the assets that will continue to rise if there's fear. So the more fear there is, the more the price of gold will go up. And that means also it will also drag other precious metals with it, like silver, for example. I'd also be looking to short some asset classes that are affected by the coronavirus. Okay, so I'll probably be short in the Chinese yuan, and there's some good gains to be made there. I'd probably be short in the Chinese stock market. This year alone, the Chinese stock market has shed 3% value, so I'd be short in those as well. I'd probably be short in oil. Okay, oil. We expect the value of oil to drop in the near term as global oil demand drops significantly. I mean, you have a lot of airlines that have actually parked their planes now, and you know that's one of the biggest demand for oil, the airline industry. Then manufacturers have shut down their factories. So I'd probably be short in oil. It's a different world, but my move into investment banking was deliberate. I definitely wanted to move into investment banking because I've always felt that there's a lot more we can offer the investing public than was available to them. So my background in banking was always in trading. So I traded currencies, I traded derivatives, and the biggest asset I got from banking and trading for banks was risk management. Because when you work in a bank trading floor, okay, what you call a dealing room, the biggest and most important thing that you're tasked with is managing risk, how to manage the bank's capital and making sure that you do not incur necessary losses or losses that exceed a certain limit. So that's the same discipline that I felt that I feel right now is the biggest asset that I brought to run in a fund like this. Because other people have tried to run funds like this, and I know a lot of them, of course, are not regulated. But what brought them down and what did they struggle with, a lot of them, was really just risk management.